grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. As our brother George has died with the Lord, so may he live with him in glory.
Our processional hymn can be found in the blue hymnals in your pews, number 263, Be Not Afraid, number 263 in the blue hymnals. You shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander far in safety, though you do not know the way. You shall speak your words in foreign lands, and all will understand. Shall see the face of God and live. Be not afraid. I go before you always. Come, follow me, and I will give you rest. If you pass through raging waters, in the sea you shall not drown. If you walk amid the burning flames, you shall not be harmed. If you stand before the power of hell, and death is at your side, know that I am with you through it all. I go before you always. Come, follow me, and I will give you rest.
Let us pray. O God, Almighty Father, our faith professes that your Son died and rose again. Mercifully grant that through this mystery, your servant George, who has fallen asleep in Christ, may rejoice to rise again through him, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the reading.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. The just man, though he die early, shall be at rest. For the age that is honorable comes not with the passing of time, nor can it be measured in terms of years. Rather, understanding is the hoary crown for men, and an unsullied life the attainment of old age. He who pleased God was loved. He who lived among sinners was transported, snatched away, lest wickedness pervert his mind or deceit beguile his soul. For the witchery of paltry things obscures what is right, and the whirl of desire transforms the innocent mind. Having become perfect in a short while, he reached the fullness of a long career, for his soul was pleasing to the Lord. Therefore he sped him out of the midst of wickedness. But people saw and did not understand, nor did they take this into account. Because grace and mercy are with his holy ones, and his care is with his elect. The word of the Lord.
The Lord is kind and merciful. The Lord is kind and merciful. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all my being bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. The Lord is kind and merciful. He pardons all your iniquities, heals all your ills. He redeems your life from destruction, crowns you with kindness and compassion. The Lord is kind and merciful. Merciful and gracious is the Lord, slow to anger and abounding in kindness. Not according to our sins does he deal with us, nor does he requite us according to our crimes. The Lord is kind and merciful. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he put our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. The Lord is kind and merciful.
Reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. We know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and place us with you in his presence. Everything indeed is for you, so that the grace bestowed in abundance on more and more people may cause the thanksgiving to overflow for the glory of God. Therefore, we are not discouraged. Rather, although our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, as we look not to what is seen, but to what is unseen. For what is seen is transitory, but what is unseen is eternal. For we know that if our earthly dwelling, a tent, should be destroyed, we have a building from God, a dwelling not made with hands, eternal in heaven. The word of the Lord.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Even if you have to die close to my word, keep faithful. For your faithfulness, I will give you the crown of life. Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God. Have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way." Thomas said to him, "Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. I begin as I begin every homily that is at a funeral mass by doing that most difficult part of any funeral homily, and that is saying two words that oftentimes can sound very empty, and those two words are, "I'm sorry," and "I am very sorry." But I have to say, as hard as they are, and sometimes situations where I'm not as familiar with the person who has died as much as I have connected with the family through the process of the grieving until the funeral, those two words are much easier to say today because I feel connected to your family from a long time ago. And this celebration of life, which is what we are about to do through this process of choosing readings and hymns and then hopefully the words that come from the mouth of the person giving the homily, who is supposed to make that dash between those two dates fully make sense, to fully give the example of what a wonderful person that life was, and then just the presence of faith. It is in this that we celebrate life, and that sometimes sounds a little awkward, but even more awkward is when we say what I've witnessed in this passing of life to eternal life is truly what I would call a happy death. Now, happy death would sound to be an oxymoron in the world. This is where we are not of the world, we are in the world. And what I saw as I was there the morning after, Father Schein was there to give that great sacrament of the anointing, the apostolic pardon, the blessing of a life that had been lived in faith to George with those who were there. And as I followed the day and watched Sarah blow in a breeze, as Sarah often does, it's her life, and does so well, and I know that because of being with Dorothy, Grandma McCabe, all those years, as Sarah would blow in and blow back out, but it was beautiful. It was beautiful because as much as I am sad, and was sad, in the faces of those who were there, there was certainly sadness, but more, there was a peace, as I saw it, and the words that were shared as Sarah, you came into the room and you prayed very well, whether you knew it or not, the words of thanksgiving to your dad for his life and for your lives and for the things that were about him in essence. If I could have, I would have taped that, and that would have been that dash that would have been between those numbers. And I could feel the harmony of a family that had been formed in that faith. And did it take away, and does it take away, the sadness of the day? No, but it is the true definition of a happy death. Because this is what I am sure George had in mind for this day. And it brings back one of the great lessons that we were taught in the seminary about this important part of life, which is called death. And I don't want to shock anyone, but we will all be here at one point. Doesn't look like anyone is shocked. That's good to know. But in that planning of life, in our formation, our professors said, plan your life from this day backwards. I would say we are celebrating the life of a man who did that quite well. He had a family. He knew what he was giving. And that obituary, so often, they are filled with things that are very much the person that we're remembering. but I have a feeling so often they contain things that are not the most important things to that person, especially as they pass from this world to the next. And the beauty of this family that I would say is someone I feel very connected to from the days of Grandma McCabe and the McCabes in the pews is that they sifted through all of the greatness of a man who did some incredible worldly things that you could hold in a scale, like Paul, who said, I've done great things. And some people hate Paul for saying that. But as my Pauline professor said, humility is truth. And Paul had done great things. But this is not the family that says great things, at least not those great things. They said the greatest thing was his ability to tell stories, with a few embellishments, apparently. And as I remind people, the best of homilies have probably two or three heresies in them, which are a mistruth, not by purpose, of course. But your dad knew what he was talking about. Your husband knew what he was talking about. Your grandfather knew what he was talking about. Your friend knew what he was talking about. But in that planning of his life, and in your witnessing that, you knew what was most important to him, and it was you. It was you, and it is you. And everything that he did, even after this time of retirement when you left the homes, and as we were talking, the home got bigger, not smaller. Sometimes that seems foolish if you don't know why it's bigger. It's bigger because it's your nest where you are supposed to come back. And it is still there to have you return back. And it was built from the beginning to be your home. And so that is the great gift of what you have learned and understood. And I saw that the morning that we were gathered in prayer. And although there were tears, and I'm not saying that you're not sad, I know that that is there. It's a balance of understanding that I saw in your faith in each of you. And that faith recognizes something very important about what we have as a church, as symbol. As you look around, you can say, I don't know what any of this stuff means. But it's not because you're not Catholic. If you're not Catholic, many of us Catholics don't know what it means either. So, you know, don't be surprised. That's why I'm here. But one of the great symbols of today, we have colors that we wear as options in a funeral celebration. The first of those is black. And black as a color, for one, I think it's beautiful. I wear it. But it is a color, and everyone looks good in it, by the way. You all look gorgeous. But it's a color that represents pain and sting of death. And that's a reality. It is the reality of today. And it hurts every one of us. And if we feel it in our lives that today we are weak of faith because we don't have the strength to kind of persevere without tears, Christ himself cried at death of his friend Lazarus, "This is your day. If that is your day and your way, you are welcome to it." It's not a weakness of faith. It's a sign of love. And Christ obviously knew about the resurrection. Nobody had to tell him. He was here to teach us that. But in those tears was also a joyfulness in our hearts. And I think that's the part of the happy death that we have to understand, is you can cry. But at the same time, there is this white that we are wearing of a resurrection that says, we're going to be okay. You've lost those that you've loved before, and it was okay. And obviously, those who were close to all of you and your family, and you're okay, and you're not just okay. You understand something in those difficult moments about what is so important to you as what you spoke so well and wrote so well in that obituary. It's you are the gifts that your mom and your dad brought into the world, and he planned it. Their life, as they both planned to be this day. And that day is, again, one of the symbols that we would have had at the beginning of a mass with a casket. Because as you probably have witnessed yourselves in these funeral celebrations, not Catholic or any denomination, in funerals, they range from a tin box, basically a pine box, or very ornate mahoganies and very expensive woods. And they come, and I have to be in awe of what I see as beauty. But then they're covered up by a pall. And what's that all about? It's about two things. It's about, one, when it's the white pall to remind us of that baptism that began that journey of George today fulfilling what God had planned for him. And I am not a God to judge, but I know from looking outside, I'd say he did pretty well. But the other thing is to cover that casket that has all that sign of beauty and wealth and all the expense that the world puts a value on and says those things aren't really that important. What you did will make a difference. But we go before God with nothing except who we created through our world and made the difference through that soul that is inside that body that we were able to have as our vessel. And again, it's beauty. It's like the most beautiful wedding I ever celebrated. It was in a chapel just outside. Two people, college students, coming to the church as converts, only their parents here. No flowers, just beauty. That's this. We don't need much to see the beauty of this life, except this. You are those buds that have grown from the stem, and you are there. That is the part that continues. And so as much as I would say I would love to begin and tell the stories of all the things that I know, and they're all good, by the way, from the Grandma McCabe years, who was so proud of all of you, as is her son, that this day was perfectly planned. It has turned out, as I would say, a mother who planted a seed in a son through her being one of parents, and I know that faith of a Dorothy McCabe. She was a tough lady. I always said I wouldn't for one mess with her, but I didn't have to. She was one of my buddies, but she always reminded me of Barbara Stanwyck in The Big Valley. Tough lady, so, and a loving lady, a generous lady, and so the apple did not fall far from the tree. But now we get to that third color, which is purple, that can be as one of the choices. And that is a color that represents change. You've got the pain. You've got the reality of the sting of death, the sadness of loss, which is a sign that you had something that was valuable. But then you have the resurrection that says life has changed, not ended. You'll hear those words, I think. That's the preface you'll be using. Life has changed, not ended. Is it that one? It's not a, whatever one it is, there is one that you can choose. That's the greatness about Catholic Church. You think everything is preset, you got choices, more than you think. But in that is the reminder that there's a life after. And it's that feeling that I had, like when I'm sure that George is, and the family that are up there is saying right now, it's like I've been here before. It's like when I came back for a celebration here covering a weekend or two. I thought, it's so beautiful. I had that sense of I've been here before. This is my family. That's what heaven's going to be like. This is like familiar. I've been here before. Because he lived in heaven in his mind and his soul. But now that gap between, what does that mean? It's the purple. It means change. Whenever the color purple is used, it means a transition to improve, to go to someplace next, beyond where we are, higher and better and holier. It's Advent, it's Lent. And so the story does not stop here. That's the key. This is not the end. And in fact, in our faith as Catholics, one of the great things of death, we often in our head, no matter what we tell ourselves, think of it as the end. When it comes to the saints, we put them on calendars and dates, not like firemen or, you know, the Dallas Cowgirls or any of that. We don't have that kind of calendar. It's a calendar that has their name on a date. And that date isn't the date they were born into the world. It's this date that they died. and we're born into eternal life. And that beginning. And so that continuation of that life is something to remember for us. Because the greatness of what I would say George sees is what he has done, and without overemphasizing what I believe is a good man with a good heart and a beautiful soul. The most important part now begins. And what is that? It's you. Primarily the front row in black, all of you here, and all of us too. It's us that says the seed like that planted in Grandpa and Grandma McCabe and the Doyles and all the family that said, I taught you, I nurtured you, I gave you all that I could give you. And watch it sprout, watch it bloom. And for you, I think that's not going to be so hard, because a lot of what people struggle with on these days ahead is that the pain of the death is so difficult. They can't talk about the stories that were part of that life. And I would never try to summarize or eulogize this life. That's your job. And so I don't think it's going to be difficult for you, because you'll understand, as you understood that day that I was there, that there in love is a very close connection when you have someone who goes beyond the world of heaven, a very close connection between laughter and tears. The stories that make you want to cry are the stories often that make you want to laugh, because they're joy and they're very close connected in emotions. And so that's what I would say is probably going to happen in the McCabe, having grown and expanded home in the next days ahead as you gather. And if it's not, remember my words, because his life has not ended, it has changed. And what I would say that hopefully you have learned as people who have been nurtured in that home is that he planned his life well, because he planned it thinking of his death, and he had a very happy one. And he wanted the same thing for you. And what was the map he used? The map he used is faith. And I love that you mentioned he was a lifelong Catholic. You could have said a deep-in Catholic, but not everyone knows what that means. He was definitely dyed in the wool. You can use all kinds of adjectives. He was that. And who benefited most from that? You. All of us, but primarily you. And I've had people come up after and speak. You don't need to do that. George speaks for himself. But people have done that, and it's okay. And in that, they often talk about the wonderful things that this person did in faith and charity and life of their going through Mass. And then as I wonder, are they doing any of that themselves? The words I heard said on that morning that I could tell reflected all of your hearts. You have faith, and it's a world that's difficult to live it in. Not impossible. It's never been easy. But you've got the support of a family that has the seeds that have been planted, the example that has been given, and a person, and many persons, that are going to be watching over you better than you could have ever had him do and them do here on earth. Trust in that. And give to those who you bring into the world, and to each other and to the world around you, that same gift that was very much given to you and that brought joy and peace to me to watch. It's a gift that I had of growing in faith and appreciation for what a family well done looks like. And that is you. Look in the mirror and see what your dad would want to see. And one has even a name that looks very much like him, by the way, George. But be that man in your way, in the way that you have been given gifts, be him. That is the greatest compliment. It's what we do to a man we call Jesus, who 2,000 years ago we are still trying to imitate and get it right. Not always doing such a great job. You're allowed to fail. Get back up and show this man, you know, what he was about and what meant the most to him. And in closing with that, I don't want to give you the whole teaching of the Catholic Church. I've given you quite a bit. So those who are not Catholic, thank you for persevering through this. But I'd like to share a poem with you. That's by my favorite author, Anonymous. And when I meet him or her in heaven, I am just going to give him or her a big hug, because a brilliant, brilliant writer of great degree. So the poem is called The Legacy. And this is based, I chose, on a statement that you put again in your homily. In your homily, I was just saying, you wrote my homily because you are you, in your obituary, about if you miss him, be kind to others, love them, and raise your kids to love God. That's what I would say also. But it says, when I die, give what is left of me to children. If you need to cry, cry for your brothers walking beside you. Put your arms around anyone and give them what you need to give to me. I want to leave you with something, something better than words or sounds. Look for me in the people I have known and loved. And if you cannot live without them and without me, then let me live on in your eyes, your mind, and your acts of kindness. You can love me most by letting hands touch hands and letting go of children that need to be free. Love does not die, people do. So when all that is left of me is love, give me away.
And for the intercession. Brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we join our prayers to his.
Please respond, Lord, hear our prayer. In baptism, George received the light of Christ. Scatter the darkness now and lead him over the waters of death. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Our brother George was nourished at the table of the Savior. Welcome him into the halls of the heavenly banquet. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Many friends and members of our family have gone before us and await the kingdom. We pray especially for Father Jim McCabe, George and Dorothy McCabe, Eileen and Bob Lenny, Joe and Grace McCabe, Kathleen Slevin, Jane Doyle, Frank Doyle, Ellen Doyle, Arthur Schwartz, and the dear friends and family of George McCabe who passed before him. Grant them an everlasting home with your son. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Many people die by violence, war, and famine each day. Show your mercy to those who suffer so unjustly these sins against your love, and gather them into the eternal kingdom of peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear
our prayer. Those who trusted in the Lord now sleep in the Lord. Give refreshment, rest, and peace to all whose faith is known to you alone. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
The family and friends of George seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our brother George. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your son's coming. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, and the voices of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ and grant them a place in the kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Our offertory hymn can be found in the red hymnal, number 900, Prayer of St. Francis, number 900 in the red hymnal. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, true faith in you. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there's despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. O Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving of ourselves that we receive, and in dying that we're born to eternal life.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice in your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and all his holy.
Amen. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant George, we beseech your mercy that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For it is at your summons that we come to birth, by your will that we are governed, and at your command that we return on account of sin to the earth from which we came. And when you give the sign, we who have been redeemed by the death of your Son shall be raised up to the glory of his resurrection. And so with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Please kneel. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May we make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your life, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfading help.
May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Timothy our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant George, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he, who was united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen, amen, amen.
Please stand. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
The questions often asked regarding who may come forward to receive Holy Communion at Catholic funerals. We know it's just practicing Catholics in a state of grace. If you are not Catholic, or if you are Catholic but not practicing or not in a state of grace, we'd still like to invite you to come forward as desired to receive a special blessing from one of the priests. Simply cross your arm over your chest or place your fingers over your lips, and the priest will give you the blessing. Thank you. Our communion hymn can be found in the blue hymnal, number 346, One Bread, One Body.
One bread, one body, one Lord of all, one cup of blessing which we bless and we Gentile or Jew, servant or free, woman or man, no more. One bread, one body, one Lord of all, one cup of blessing which we bless, and we, the many, throughout the earth, we are one body in this one.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them. They turn away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart.
Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body food for the journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our brother George may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
In paradisum educate angeli, in tuo adventu suscipiate martires, et perducate in civitatem santa Jerusalem. Chorus angelorum te suscipiat, et cum Lazaro quondam paupere aeterna.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother George, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon George in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In the sure hope of the resurrection, we take leave of our brother. Let us go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Our recessional hymn can be found in the blue hymnal number 261, On Eagle's Wings. Number 261, On Eagle's Wings, in the blue hymnal.
Shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow for life. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock, in whom I trust, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings. The sun and hold you in the palm of his hand. The snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under his wings your His faithfulness, your shield, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun. His hand. You need not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, though thou wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. For to his angels he's given a command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand.